I'm Bob Herbert. Welcome to Op-Ed.TV. A story we don't hear a lot about is the way that Vladimir Putin, in his continuing onslaught against Ukraine, has politicized and weaponized homophobia. His troops have used harassment, humiliation, and vicious physical attacks against gays, including sexual violence and torture, as tools to help advance Putin's war aims. My guest is an American journalist who has traveled to Ukraine as part of a growing effort to document these war crimes, to bring them to the public's attention, and hopefully to help curb them. He's J. Lester Fader, a reporter, photographer, and former BuzzFeed correspondent who has written a compelling piece for the New York Times that carried the stunning headline, "Wear It or We'll Beat You to Death." He's also a senior fellow at our own CUNY Law School. Welcome. Thanks for coming in. I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
So the piece you did for the Times opens with a Ukrainian man, 22 years old, being stopped at a checkpoint by Russian soldiers. Who was that person and what happened to him?
So his name was Alexei Peluchin, and he was on his way, he says, to take pictures of a victory march that the Russians had organized. And when they stopped him at the checkpoint, they found pictures on his phone of some stuff that he'd been doing trying to get the word out about the occupation. But they also went through his Telegram chats and found LGBT-themed chats, including one that he ran. They immediately started calling him homophobic names. They asked a passerby on the street what they thought should be done with gay people in the city, wow, not using less polite language.
Right.
That man responded that they should be killed. And then they threw him in a truck and beat him and took him to a detention center where he would spend the next 6 weeks or so.
Wow. So among the things that the Russians were seeking from him were the names of other LGBTQ activists.
That's correct.
Who apparently were active in the whole wartime situation. I found that extremely
yeah.
unusual. So talk about that. I mean, how many of these activists are they, and what are the kinds of things they're doing?
So the people that they, so there were eight names, Alexei said, that they asked him about specifically. And most of the people, as far as I know, that were on that list had actually already fled. But there is a close link between the LGBT movement, the pro-democracy movement, the resistance to Russia.
Right.
And we know from inside of Russia itself that the crackdown on LGBT people has been part of a broad-based campaign on cracking down on civil society and democratic organizations inside of Russia. So the sense that I've gotten in general was that LGBT people were perceived as a threat, or LGBT activists were perceived as a threat in the way that many activists of various kinds were perceived as a threat. But there was an additional element, which is that going back to 2012, 2013, Putin started to embrace a kind of morals politics. And that was very important in Russia's turn against LGBT people. And that was rhetoric that he used, we know, you know, ahead of the 2014 Olympics. It played a role in the original invasion of Donbass and the seizing of Crimea in 2014. And it was rhetoric he used once again in the lead up to the full-scale invasion in 2022. So that has had an impact in the whole climate of the way that Russians and Russian-aligned forces in Ukraine are regarding the LGBT movement and LGBT individuals.
Talk a little bit about the ways in which the gay community in Russia and in Ukraine have been affected by this broad homophobic policy.
Sure. So it's a kind of complicated story. I'll try to make it as simple as possible.
That's fine.
But going back to the early parts of the teens, Putin had a political problem where his popularity was flagging. And one of the strategies for reviving that enthusiasm was to tie himself more closely to the Orthodox Church in particular, and more generally began a narrative of standing up for quote-unquote traditional values against other forces that may want to undermine them.
All kinds of irony there, but
exactly. But it's not, you know, it is a political strategy that's not foreign to our American
right.
political environment.
Right.
Coincided with a local level push, I believe out of St. Petersburg, to pass the first version of what became known as a gay propaganda law, which nominally was specifically targeting information about LGBT materials in schools, so not unlike the Don't Say Gay law in Florida, but was in a Russian environment could be applied much more broadly to crack down on speech around LGBT issues and to clamp down on LGBT organizations. This became a national law in 2013, and Putin signed it. And it, most in Russia were sort of surprised that it got much international attention.
Right.
But it also smacked right into the lead up to the Olympics. The international outcry about the law and the lead up to the Olympics turned into a domestic political opportunity for Putin, was a way for him to even more powerfully portray himself as defending Russian values against Western values,
right,
against degenerates and all this other rhetoric that he used. At that same time, the Ukraine was supposed to sign what's called the association agreement with the EU, which was a step to formalizing ties with the EU that Ukraine hoped would eventually lead to EU membership. Putin was very bitterly opposed to this.
Right.
And I did a story back in 2013, right before that agreement was supposed to be signed, about an oligarch who was close to Putin put up ads on bus stations saying that association with the EU means same-sex marriage.
Wow.
There were a lot of protests in the street against the EU by Russian-aligned protesters who were using very vulgar slogans about homosexuality and the EU. So this was all sort of happening broadly. And we saw at the time, while the crackdown on LGBT people in Russia was escalating, that also in states in sort of Russia's sphere of influence or places that they wanted to keep in its sphere of influence, local politicians aligned with Russia were bringing up gay propaganda laws. There were other kinds of, there were attacks on pride events, a whole bunch of things that were happening to try to polarize society around LGBT issues, but with a broader geopolitical goal of tying Eastern Europe closer to Russia and moving away from the West. Well, another example is familiar to your audience. It might be in Hungary, which is, of course, technically part of the EU. It was one of the most progressive of the Eastern Bloc countries initially when it came into the EU in terms of LGBT rights, and then moved radically in the opposite direction at the same time that Orban was becoming closer to Putin.
So how did you become so involved in the Russian treatment of gays in Ukraine?
So back in 2013, BuzzFeed hired me to pioneer an LGBT rights beat for the international desk. And Ukraine was actually the first place that I went. And it was an important story because I was interested in the ways that LGBT issues were part of the broad stories of geopolitical power, of democracy versus totalitarianism.
We see it everywhere.
Around the same time that the anti-gay laws in Uganda were gaining steam, an anti-gay law in Nigeria passed, and it was affecting the politics of global aid, there were all these really big issues that were bubbling to the surface. It was clear that this competition that was forming between Russia and the EU, and more broadly between an anti-democratic system and democratic systems, was going to be the big storyline of the next decade, and
right,
indeed it's one we're still living. And Ukraine was the clearest place to tell that story, and that was what started that interest. And it's a thread I chased to a lot of different countries over the 7 years I was at BuzzFeed, but Ukraine has been an important touchstone throughout. So when the full-scale invasion started, I knew I needed to go back.
Wow. Did you have any trouble getting into Ukraine?
No. Ukraine is very encourages Western reporters,
right,
to come. They want the story to get out. And also that the Ukrainian government and the Ukrainian public more broadly have actually gotten much more supportive of LGBT rights in the course of this war.
That's interesting.
It's really interesting. The real response is being reflected in public opinion. That people are more supportive of LGBT rights in Ukraine. We've also saw the first hate crime legislation addressing sexual orientation and gender identity passed by the Ukrainian parliament. There was a national petition drive to build support for partnership rights for same-sex,
wow,
couples. And that largely has to do with support for LGBT troops who don't have any, their partners have no survivor's benefits, they're not able to claim their bodies. So it's been a real sea change in Ukraine. It's not decisive. There's still a lot of,
right,
a lot of homophobia in Ukraine. The partnership legislation has not happened yet. But it is a much more supportive environment than it was even in a couple years earlier.
So I mentioned in the intro that the treatment of gays in Ukraine by the Russian soldiers, that those are war crimes. I mean, there's no doubt in my mind. If you're thinking in terms of international tribunals, the international courts, and that sort of thing, if you're looking at these activities through those lenses, how are they viewed, and are they viewed as war crimes?
It may be helpful to start with a domestic context where, so let's say somebody is arrested for killing a gay person because they were gay. Mm-hmm. In some states, in every state, right, you'd have a crime of murder. Mm-hmm. But in some states, you also have a hate crime. Yep. that the bias that motivated the crime is also something that is punished. International law has a bit of an analogy where mistreatment of individuals is a war crime, but only in certain circumstances do we punish the motivation that led to the targeting of particular groups. And genocide is the best known term of that, which is about trying to wipe out an entire ethnic, national, or religious group. There's also a concept called persecution that can also be used. Now, in international law, there has been on the books for about 20 years now something called gender persecution. That is, by itself, was controversial when it was created in the 1990s in a treaty. And it is only now being prosecuted for the first time at the ICC and the International Criminal Court. That we're going to see whether we can get convictions for people. These are just in cases where the targeting of women. Jurists in recent years have done incredible work making the case that LGBT people should be covered as a form of gender persecution. The argument being that, you know, if troops are targeting people because of their sexual orientation or gender identity, what they're really doing is enforcing certain ideas of what a man should be like and what a woman should be like, their gender norms. And so that bias is something that leads them to commit violence, and therefore it is a form of gender persecution. This interpretation has been embraced by the chief prosecutor of the International Criminal Court. Some of the most important work in making this case has been done at Lisa Davis in the Human Rights and Gender Justice Clinic at CUNY Law School. But we've never seen any charges brought to attempt to prosecute somebody for LGBT persecution under international law, and we don't know whether judges will agree with this interpretation. So that's the status there.
So where does this stand now? I mean, what cases are percolating through the system? Who's leading the effort? Talk a little bit about that.
So I think the first challenge, and that was one of the things I was trying to bring out in my piece, is we need real investigation. And for something to constitute a crime against humanity, it has to be widespread and systematic. So we would need a pattern of violence against LGBT people. And that evidence does not yet exist, but a lot of that has to do with the barriers that come with reporting. I mentioned in the story that the organization that did some of the documentation around the cases that I did report, they had the 30 additional cases. They came up with, I think, three very significant cases. And this is from a city, they were looking just in the city of Kherson, which is a population of about 250,000 people in a country of 40 million people. So they got three pretty substantial cases. They had 30 additional cases that involved accusations of sexual assault and other very serious abuses that they had not yet been able to investigate simply because of a lack of resources to do the investigation. There also were a lot of other people who refused to speak with them because just on the other side of the river from Kherson, the Russians are still occupying Ukrainian territory, and there's fear of reprisals. So to really know whether this is widespread and systematic, and there are a lot of evidence that this is happening in other places, we just don't know at the scale, you'd have to have a real infrastructure to be able to collect those cases and to do the documentation. And that's challenging right now because, as we're seeing on the military side, money to support Ukrainian civil society is also drying up. LGBT organizations switched to doing humanitarian work when the war began. They are incredibly burned out, they are under-resourced, and they're losing funding as the Western funders lose interest. So that's a significant concern. Ultimately, the International Criminal Court is going to have to do its own investigations if they want to bring charges about this. And they need to invest the resources and their people to do that investigation.
Explain why this is important. What would it mean if these crimes could be designated war crimes or, in effect, crimes against humanity?
One question I got as I was working on this piece is like, why should the treatment of LGBT people be handled differently than the treatment of anybody else?
And which is the same thing that happened with the hate crime legislation here in the States.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And as we know, if we, you know, we look at the history of the lynching of African Americans or in international context, the Holocaust, right. We know that there are times that political violence is bigger than the individual crimes that are committed on particular people, that there is a bigger goal that affects an entire group. And it's important to name that crime if we want to do anything about it. We're seeing now in Russia an escalation of the anti-LGBT campaign. Just very recently, the Russian government designated what they call the international LGBT movement as an extremist group. They added it to the list that puts it in the category of terrorist organizations. We've seen arrests of people, everybody from operators of gay clubs to a woman who was wearing rainbow earrings. It's really quite terrifying. We also saw in Russian context a lead up of vigilante attacks on LGBT wow. people. We're seeing now with increased anti-LGBT rhetoric, especially around schools, an increase in attacks on LGBT children. So this kind of rhetoric has a much broader impact. And in the same way that it was important to criminalize lynching or to name the Holocaust a genocide and to win convictions for the persecution of the Jews, law does many things. One of the things it does is it sets the boundaries of right and wrong. It's the story that we tell ourselves about what's acceptable. And right now it's far too acceptable in so many contexts to go after LGBT people. And it's a tool that's used by totalitarian leaders in Russia, in Uganda, and some would argue here in the United States. It's very important that international law recognize this as a serious crime that is deserving of full sanction.
To me, this is the way, you know, looking back historically, this is the way things change, the way societies change. You have legal activism, you have legal fights, hopefully you have legal decisions and stuff, but you also have the journalism that covers all of this, and it begins to come to the attention of the wider public, and consciousness gets raised. You know, it's kind of hard to define specifically what was the most important aspect, but the totality of it can have a profound effect.
Absolutely.
You pointed out that it's often difficult to prosecute gender-based crimes for a variety of reasons. Talk about that.
Well, one is simply just the difficulty that victims have in reporting. We know this is well established in a bunch of contexts that it's very hard for victims to talk about the trauma they've experienced. It's even harder in a context where they expect not to be believed, or they expect to be judged, or they feel shame because of what happened to them. In a Ukrainian context, the first opportunity to report a lot of what happened to them may be to Ukrainian authorities. Well, it didn't have the Ukrainian justice system did not work great in the first case. So there's Aleta Shevchenko, who's a very well-known lesbian activist, was assaulted on the street early in the full-scale invasion. And she told me about trying to go to get that registered as an attack. And she had to go to three different offices. Originally, they didn't want to take the case because they didn't want the paperwork. It was like a whole ordeal. Well, imagine you're a gay man who's experienced being raped. Right. Or you are a lesbian woman who has been sexually assaulted in detention because you're a lesbian. Just going through that ordeal and then to have no expectation that any investigation, any justice would come on the other side would be hard enough, not to mention the fact that you might be afraid that people would shame you, that you would encounter homophobic treatment. There's a lot of reasons on that basis. There's also the problem that, you know, historically, gender-based violence hasn't been regarded as a serious crime.
Right.
For a long time, rape was regarded as essentially a spoil of war, that soldiers were, it was part of their compensation. And we get the first mentions of rape in tribunals, the Tokyo Tribunal, I believe, is the first time that was really mentioned in a judgment. Mm-hmm. But even there, it was a passing paragraph in a much larger judgment. It was dealing with one particular massacre committed by the Japanese. Completely left out of the charges and out of the judgment was the enslavement of some 200,000 so-called comfort women as sexual slaves for the Japanese army. That is astonishing. It's not until the 90s in Rwanda that we got the first war crimes tribunal where rape was recognized as a crime serious enough to be treated as a form of crime against humanity, to be recognized as a tool of genocide. These kind of like top tiers, there's a sort of hierarchy of crimes between like a felony and a misdemeanor, that was recognized as rape and sexual violence was a very serious crime. And then that did lead to sort of momentary changes in international law. I mentioned the treaty that established gender persecution, but then prosecutors have been afraid to use it or didn't think it was well, that the precedent was clearly established.
You're writing a book.
I am writing a book.
Talk about that. What's it about and when can we expect it?
Well, the book I'm working on most immediately is, I'm calling it The Queer Face of War. And it's going to be a combination of photo documentary and written profiles of queer Ukrainians telling the story of the LGBT movement over the past decade, its relationship with the pro-democracy movement, and then the war with Russia. I'm hoping that that's currently currently working with an agent to get that sold. I'm hoping that will come out in the near future. I'm also working with my colleague Gina Moore on a bigger history of gender persecution and how we get from this massive sea change from it being regarded as just a thing that men do in war to being treated as a serious war crime. That's a bigger undertaking, and I will. That's TBD on when that's coming about.
But you're also a photographer.
I'm also a photographer.
Wow.
And you know, it was interesting doing this work with in Ukraine was really eye-opening for me. I've been covering LGBT people in conflict for a decade. I worked on Iraq and Syria and Afghanistan. And when I first went to interview Ukrainians, it sort of as an afterthought would ask if I could take their picture. And they said yes. And I realized this is the first time I've covered a war where LGBT people are targeted and they're willing to show their faces.
Wow.
There's a overlapping of both the political pressure from Russia and the relative safety of Ukraine, that people are able to talk honestly as queer people about what that's meant for them in conflict. And we know, and it's been very clear, especially in the past decade, this goes back obviously to the Holocaust, where some 15,000 gay men were sent to the concentration camps. But more recently, when ISIS was throwing people accused of homosexuality off of buildings, this got a lot of attention, but no Iraqi could tell their story if we could find them.
Right.
Even if they were someplace safe, and I've been dealing this more with Afghanistan, the family members would be in danger if they came out publicly. So it was really important to me when I started encountering a number of LGBT people willing to show their faces, to take their pictures, to make that part of the story. Because we know historically for queer people, visibility is power. And pictures matter.
This is the reason why journalism is important, why journalism matters, because these stories get out, people really don't know about them, or they don't know about them in depth, and it's really, and it requires courage to do the kind of stuff that you do and people you work with do. You actually touched on this a little earlier. Americans seem to be losing some of their interest in the war in Ukraine. We've got a presidential election going on. We've got the conflict in Israel between the Israelis and Hamas. Why should Americans continue to care about what happens in Ukraine? Why should Americans care about that war? And more specifically, why should they care about what happens to gays in Ukraine in that war?
I would say two things. We in the United States are very clear in the way that Russia's geopolitical ambitions have affected our own politics, right, with the election meddling in 2016. Russia has a broader goal in destabilizing democratic world, undermining international human rights norms, and that is something that affects all of us. And our democracy here is under threat. What's happening in Ukraine is a more extreme version, but in some ways against some of the same adversaries. And that's a fight that we really should see through. I would also say that the importance about LGBT people, it's we know that when a democratic space starts to collapse, that vulnerable groups broadly are attacked. And that's queer people in a lot of parts of the world are among the most vulnerable. But we're seeing that here. And what's happening in the attacks on LGBT people, yeah. on transgender people, it's the same. You know, we get a Don't Say Gay law in Florida. We also get legislation that restricts the teaching of racism. These are things that happen together. And In some places, like Ukraine, LGBT people are a canary in the coal mine, but we do need to be worried about the whole coal mine.
Right.
And the structure of democracy that is about protecting minorities within that is something that all Americans should be invested in. If we have time, I want to come back to what you said about journalism. LGBT issues, women's issues in some cases, are often covered as afterthoughts or not done very well. It's really important to make sure that sexual violence reporting, gender-based violence reporting, LGBT rights reporting is not a sideshow. It is part of this big storyline about what's happening in the world. I'm working right now to try to see if there's funding to set up a center on gender and sexuality reporting to help elevate both the attention on that and also help support a community of journalists who are thinking about how to do this well, because I think it's something that the profession in general needs to invest in.
So good luck.
Thank you very much.
We're going to have to end it there. We've been speaking with J. Lester Fader. I want to thank you for coming in. I'm Bob Herbert. I want to thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.